tardes y bienvenidos de vuelta. Yo diría que este es nuestro sexto bloque. Y antes que nada, antes de presentar a Lisa, agradecerle a Templeton Foundation porque de alguna manera, gracias a ellos, tenemos esta charla magistral de Lisa, gracias a Templeton. Y de paso agradecerle a Craig Smith, que ha sido un gran apoyo para organizar todo este evento. Y déjenme presentarle a Lisa Hill. Ella ha viajado desde Australia para estar con nosotros. Solo, yo diría, hoy día se ha recuperado algo de las 12 horas de diferencia. Tenemos el privilegio de tenerla con nosotros. Como ustedes ven, el título de su presentación, Anne Smith, sobre la felicidad, el bienestar, la desigualdad y el Estado, es muy amplio, tan amplio como ha sido su trayectoria intelectual. Ella es gran conocedora de la Ilustración escocesa, de Adam Smith, tiene estudios seminales en Adam Ferguson, un libro que es una referencia obligada, y como profesora de la Universidad de Adelaide en Australia, profesora de ciencia política. También sus recientes estudios en ciencia política tienden a estudiar desde el punto de vista empírico, con influencia también de Adam Smith probablemente, en el voto obligatorio, que es algo que para nosotros los chilenos es algo muy contingente. Ella publicó un libro muy importante recientemente con Jason Brennan sobre el voto obligatorio. Así que eso es parte de los grandes intereses que han, yo diría, pavimentado, no pavimentado, una fea palabra, sino que alimentado la vida intelectual de Lisa. Aprovecho de contarles también que entiendo que actualmente, no sé si ya es real o no, pero es presidenta o será presidenta del Adam Smith International Society. Así que para nosotros, en esta ocasión, es realmente un privilegio poder contar con la presencia de Lisa Hill entre nosotros. Así que les pido un aplauso para ella.
Wow, thank you for that lovely introduction, Leon, especially for plugging my other work. Good work. And thank you all for being here today, and I'm very happy to be here in Chile and talking about Adam Smith. And thank you also to Templeton and Craig for organising my visit here, as well as Leon and everyone else, and Nicole. So today I'm talking about Adam Smith from a big picture point of view. What was Adam Smith up to in terms of public policy? What was his idea of a successful state? What was his advice to the legislator? What had to change? What new things should we be doing now? And I'm focusing here on his idea of happiness, his new focus on welfare, his interest in inequality, and his idea of what a successful state was. So it's about what Smith's science of the legislator was and about what goals the modern legislator should now pursue and how should they pursue them. How was he going to approach the art of governing and managing populations in commercialising economies? I'm trying to show the big and quite conflicted picture. It's a very complex picture. What he's trying to do is exceedingly complex in a period of incredible change, where we're moving into mass society and where the old way of doing things is completely wrong in his point of view. And he's coming at it from many different angles. So I'm trying to show the majesty and the mystery and also the tensions that are there. And in a way, I'm discombobulating as I start off. A lot of it is saying, what's going on here? Why is this contradiction here? Why is this tension here? And towards the end, I start to try and show how we might reconcile them. So he had his own questions. What were the chief tasks before the state? And why were these the tasks? What had to change in order for the state to succeed? How should success be achieved and then measured? So he wanted to be able to measure the success, and that was a new thing, trying to measure success and to measure how we were doing. And the really big question there is, what is the role of natural liberty in the successful state? And then what is the job of the state in securing welfare, getting the job done? And this relationship is very tricky in Smith. I have my own questions that I'm posing as I'm going along, answering Smith's questions to himself and the reader, and my own questions to Smith. How radical or reformist was he in approaching this question? So it goes to the sort of left-right issues that Sam was talking about the other day. And also Maria Pia was talking about as well. Also, how committed to the commercial system was he? How libertarian was he? Sometimes he doesn't seem so libertarian as we expect. And can the apparent contradictions around the respective responsibilities of the market and the state be reconciled in Smith? Sometimes it looks very wobbly. And there are a lot of tensions in his attitudes to the poor as well, and I try and address those. So what's he start off doing? He starts off by trying to reconstruct the art of statecraft. He doesn't like the way it's being done so far, and he's rejecting the traditional accounts of statecraft, which considered things only from the point of view of elites and the benefits to them. And they confined their attention to things that he thought were worthless: military conquest, perpetuating the power and the glory of the state. He said, what is this? Just so the boys can go to the pub and say, look how big my country is, look who I vanquished. This is not what we should be doing. Think of the costs. He thought war and military imperialism was pointless. It was wasteful. It brought on a lot of debt, it brought on a lot of corruption. It destabilised the economy and it brought untold suffering. Stop doing that. Also, the British state itself, and Maria Pia talked about this as well, there was all the state capture, which was driving him crazy. He hated corruption, and I've argued in previous work that he's an early corruption theorist. He's very important in driving the modern conception of corruption. He said that the way that the British elites were pursuing national greatness was the opposite of welfare enhancement. So this is what he wanted, welfare enhancement. So things have got to change. The statecraft needed a major overhaul in terms of the hows and the whats and the whys. Everything needed a reshift, a reshuffle. So here I'm kind of looking at the goals and peculiarities of his method, how he redefined even the concept of welfare and the whole idea of what a successful state was. Let's rethink. What does it mean to be successful? And then I explore those questions by looking at his solutions to the alleviation of poverty, food insecurity, social and economic inequality, worker exploitation, indigence, and declining levels of education. I also touch on his kind of odd attitude to slavery. And all these issues tested the limits of his faith in the market and in the ability of the state to solve the problems. And as he's sort of trying to work through these issues, he sometimes appears to some scholars as a radical left thinker, to others as a very cold-hearted right thinker. So I'm trying to work through those issues and see where we can place him. And really, of course, as Sam has alluded to, he's not the left-right continuum doesn't mean anything for Smith. It didn't mean anything at that time, and it didn't mean anything for Smith. It's a who cares issue for Smith. It's what do I need to do to get the job done? That's all he really cares about, I think. And we see him switching a lot because he's just trying to get the job done. He'll switch back and forth between a collective left-type solution and an individual-level sort of rightish-looking solution. So I'm addressing the limits and that tension here, and I'm going to show that those limits of his faith in markets and the states are less fixed than we might think. And the big question then is, how good is natural liberty at delivering welfare and alleviating poverty in Smith's own mind? He wanted to redirect political economy to focus on two neglected aspects. The welfare of the average person, let's bring it down to earth. And then the welfare of the average person against the rise of modern trade and manufacture and consumerism, which were the distinctive attributes of modern states, as Fania Ross Salzberger has acutely pointed out. It's going to be a modern political economy, he says. So how's he going to redefine state success? Well, it's going to be about welfare. It's going to be about prosperity, and it's, number one, going to be about happiness. Let's think about happiness. Why doesn't anyone talk about happiness, Smith wonders. Let's do that. The wealth of nations does not consist in terms of, say, public virtue, and I'm thinking either the Christian virtue or sort of like a Fergusonian type civic virtue. It's not, as per the McCandless, gold stockpiles, a favourable balance of trade, or the extent of conquered territories, as elites were defining it. But it's more human and material, as the people themselves would define it. He's saying, how's the average person feel today? What's their life like today? Are they hungry? Are they in despair? Are they ashamed to be seen on the streets in the rags they're wearing? Are they happier or less happy than they were yesterday? So the wise legislator is going to ask themselves a whole new set of questions. Do the people enjoy sufficient freedom, security and social and political stability? Stability is super important for Smith. We must not underestimate that. He likes progress, but stability is very important. Is everyone tolerably well fed, clothed and lodged? Was the population growing, excuse me, or declining? And had infant mortality rates risen to unconscionable levels? Had infanticide become more common? And Smith was a little bit absorbed with this question of infanticide, and Maria Pia talked about that as well. It really upset him. Fancy having a situation where people kill their own children because they can't feed them. We're doing something wrong here. Also, were people paid enough? And could they live with dignity? This is very important. Smith is such a subtle psychologist and sociologist. There's more to life than having enough to eat. It's just as important to feel that you have a sense of social dignity, that you can go about in society without having to feel ashamed of yourself. And of course, were people happy? This is a perfectly legitimate question, he says, for the political economist to ask. Of course happiness is important, and we should assess any public policy against that standard. But this gives his thought a surprisingly kind of utilitarian or positive liberty type flavour. What are we getting at the end of it all? If we don't get a happier population, then we're doing something wrong. So his idea of happiness, I believe, is very worldly. Material, it's highly pragmatic. In order to be happy and flourishing, you have to have prosperity and material abundance. And he thinks we're human beings, we're actually made to really enjoy prosperity. This is the natural joy of prosperity. And I think he believes that this has a teleological aspect. We were created by the divine architect to want and enjoy being safe, prosperous, and to be able to reproduce ourselves. And so we're given the self-regarding drives so we can do that. These self-regarding drives aren't bad. We shouldn't pathologize them. They're a good thing. They're a sign, and he takes this from Stoicism, that the Creator loves us and wants us to be okay. So how can the worldly happiness be achieved? What is this science of the legislator? And as you're all aware, he's pretty anti-utopian. Look, he said, I got a kind of a system, the natural liberty system, but let's not get carried away with perfection of police, you know, public administration, as something we can really achieve. That's a noble and magnificent idea, and he's being a bit sarcastic here. But in the end, the constitutions of government is only good as their tendency to promote the happiness of those who live under them. This is their sole end and use. If your constitution of government and your way of doing things isn't delivering happiness, then you've got to rethink it. So don't start off with a utopian model. Build on it, muddle through, do a bit of ad hocery, see how you go. And therefore, it's going to be a bit messy looking at times. And so that's what I want to stress. I'm showing how messy his system can be. But he's saying that's how it is in life. We're dealing with the unpredictable human element in a period of massive social change. We're moving to mass society and we're moving towards the Industrial Revolution. We're not there yet. What the hell's going on and how can we manage it all? And he's trying to understand all that. And I think he understands it extremely well. So his baseline is maximise negative liberty. That's the default position. But use an ad hoc approach that's cautious and sceptical of system. If you're one of these well-meaning legislators that's gripped by a spirit of system and you want to relieve the unfortunate of their inconveniences and distresses, do not proceed in haste or in a radical sort of a way. That's going to cause more harm than good. Just be cautious. Apply palliatives. Just to do a little solution and a sort of ad hoc solution at a time. Incremental solutions. Reasonable accommodations. Don't rush in. You don't know what the unintended effects are going to be. And he understood that at a sociological level, development must happen very slowly so populations can adapt and so that it's adapting in a sensitive sort of incremental way. But that also explains a lot of the puzzles in the system, that it seems like he's making it up as he goes along, He is. He is making it up as he goes along. That's okay. So he aimed to produce a political science or economy for modern times that embodied not only universal principles, so he hopes he can apply some of these principles universally, but they've got to have principles of justice in them, but also, he says, expediency too. Sometimes we've just got to be expedient. We want to have a system that we can adopt in order to regulate the social order, so to have a well-functioning society that's orderly, and to ensure that the advantages of living in political union are distributed as evenly as possible among all the different members of a community. The benefits can't be just accruing to the elites. The idea is to get happiness spread as widely as possible. And this is going to be tricky given some of his other commitments. Sounds a lot like utilitarianism. It's also a lot like positive liberty. And this desire for justice and expediency and distributing advantages as evenly as possible also explain a lot of the tensions and the mess that we see in the Smithian system. But as I've said before, if we didn't have all these tensions and mess and complexity, there'd be nothing for any of us to do. And so there's plenty for us to do. And trying to understand him as well, but also reconciling the different parts. So his main thought is, look, maximise negative liberty, that's going to promote welfare, but sometimes you're going to have to think outside the natural liberty box. But mainly, we're going to try and think within the natural liberty box. So he could sometimes talk tough about negative liberty, but then abandon it when it wasn't getting the effects he wanted, when it wasn't giving us prosperity, welfare, order and security. There was a lot on his wish list, and so this is a lot to balance. Sometimes it even seems like negative liberty is just a means to an end. But no, he likes negative liberty. He's a negative liberty guy. But sometimes he just throws it out and says, that's not working. Today we're going to have to do some interventions. So back to the welfare of the people. Political economy has two key urgent objects. One, to enrich and provide for the people, but here's the important qualification, to enable them to provide for themselves. You can't just be have an economy based on handouts and giving people, taking care of people all the time. In a mass society especially, people have to be enabled to look after themselves. After all, as Smith believes, we're made to be able to be independent and autonomous. We can do it. And to supply the Commonwealth with a revenue sufficient for the public service to have enough taxes to be able to do what people can't do for themselves, the collective action problems. He wanted a society that could deliver human flourishing to promote happiness and guard against misery. It sounds so Epicurean to me at some points. And here's the indicators he used. So here's what the legislature should have a list of, and you should be able to tick off all these things that you're getting right. Security, number one. Like all good political theorists, security is your number one responsibility. Then you've got to have food security. That's basic. What about your population levels? Are they going up or down? Smith says if they're going down, something's wrong. They should be going forward. Productivity and employment levels. Everyone should be employed and we should have a productive society. Wage levels should not be low. They should not be below subsistence. What are general living conditions? How about how many beggars there are on the streets? And I'm thinking if Smith was a statistician today, he'd be going out and sending his RAs out into the street and counting every week how many people were begging on the street as a good indicator of how the economy was doing and of how the economy was being managed as well. What were literacy and numeracy levels like? He cared about that. Child mortality rates and the ability to live with social dignity. His idea of welfare was very broad. It was concerned with more than just subsistence. And I won't spend too much time on this slide because we've had a lot of talks about the linen shirt. But he understood, as an early sociologist, and I have argued that he's a sociologist and a very fine one. It's relative. In France, you don't mind wearing clogs. In England, you do. But everybody needs to be able to feel that they can go out in public and not be ashamed. They need something. So in his treatment of these issues, sometimes he struck people as a left Smith and a right Smith. For example, Martha Nussbaum thinks he's indifferent to the poor and is prepared to let the market do its worth with little constraint. I think his attitude is a bit more complicated than this, and I do understand why she thinks that, because at times he does seem quite callous, and at other times not. He did have great, sometimes blind faith in markets to assist the poor most of the time, but he certainly was not indifferent to the poor. They were number one on his list of things he cared about. And he did not believe the market got the job done all the time. Some, on the other hand, have described his political economy as radical and even revolutionary in its attitude to the poor. Now, even though it's radical and revolutionary in the way he's trying to change the way we do statecraft, it's not ideologically radical. He doesn't think that commercialism should be transcended. And he doesn't think even class privilege should be 100% transcended, and I'll explain why in a minute. Class distinctions have utility, and advancing commercialism should be welcomed because it helps the poor. And we know he was always working, usually behind the scenes in quite a cunning, persuasive way, exerting his influence on successive reform movements that helped the poor. Reform movements of taxation, food security, mass education, higher wages and labour laws. He was also a critic of many welfare negating practices such as the poor laws and the settlement laws, which hurt the poor more than anyone, religious interference in politics, political corruption, the archaic laws controlling inheritance and workers' rights, slavery, and the extravagant public debt. The public debt drove him crazy. So much waste within the British state. These were all violations of the system of natural liberty, and suppressed wages, which I'm going to talk about now, are a very good example of his concern for the poor inside his commitment to the system of natural liberty. So this was a mercantilist policy, the utility of wages doctrine, that dominated in his time. And you can see why he really does not like the mercantilists. They argue that if you pay workers almost starvation wages, they will try harder, work very hard to get more money. And also you shouldn't pay them too much because they might buy gin and become vicious in their behaviour. And he says, and I think he's being sarcastic here, it's not very probable that men in general should work better when they're ill-fed than they are well-fed. He says that doctrine is just silly. Low wages also lead to crime and other social disorders. So there are the bad effects of low wages. If they fall below the community standard, people will be driven to begging or a life of crime. Nobody will be so mad to expose himself upon the highway if he can make a better bread in an honest and industrious manner. And many objected to his call for higher wages. And he said, look, don't be silly. No society can be flourishing and happy, of which the greater part of the members are poor and miserable. National opulence is the opulence of the whole people, not just a few of them. Now, apart from these kind of utility and public order considerations, the utility of poverty doctrine also constituted a noxious violation of the system of natural liberty. This is also why it's bad. It looks bad, it is bad, it feels bad, but it's also interfering with the system of natural liberty, in which Smith posits a natural wage, where wages would naturally equilibrate if state policy and mercantilist policy wasn't getting in the way. And that would be a subsistence wage for both the worker and his family in order to ensure that the race of workmen lasted beyond the first generation. So you can't pay people so low that they can't afford to reproduce themselves. Where's the labour supply going to come from? And you can't have growth if population growth isn't happening. If you don't have workers to feed growth, this isn't going to work out. Here's another example of sympathy for the poor, but again within the bounds of natural liberty, and Maria Pia also talked about this issue. And this is the right to organise. And when you're reading the passages here, I mean, he's really on the side of the workers. He said, whenever workers agitate for higher wages, they always lose because it's easier for the employers to combine and they can do it in secret. Nobody can see them doing it because there's less of them. But the main problem there is that the state takes the side of the employers and punishes the workers and ignores what's going on with the employers, even though they're unionising too. So given those comments, some have suggested that Ms. Smith thinks this asymmetry should be corrected through legislation by allowing workers to unionise. No, he does not say that. He only says that the law should be dealt impartially, that is, treat masters in the same manner, so meaning both should be prosecuted. He really does not like combinations or unions. He's so averse to them that he even prescribes any regulation which obliges all of those of the same trade to register, because this would enable them to organise. And then I think he goes too far with the next reason, the next example of why we shouldn't have these registrations. Industries should not have to provide for their sick, their poor, their widows and orphans, because this would mean we'd have to keep a list of the workers, and then this would mean they could organise. So natural liberty wins in a very big way in Smith's battle against poverty. That doesn't mean he didn't care about the average person. That's why he was always talking about corn, always talking about the corn supply, because it's the main reason why he opposed monopoly and why he advocated free trade, I think. And it's the main job of political economy to find ways of improving the per capita consumption of the labouring classes. And again, the silliness of the mercantilists strikes us now in hindsight, but people really believed that non-consumables like gold were wealth. Smith says, that's not wealth, you can't eat gold. It's the consumptibility of a thing that makes it useful. Opulence consists not in money, but the abundance of necessaries and conveniences of life, but also their cheapness, they have to be cheap. And the only way to get that is to have unrestrained freedom of the corn trade, even in a time of famine, although as Sam pointed out, he would countenance perhaps a cap on the price of bread during a famine. So welfare for Smith is achieved by expanding liberty. And within the system of natural liberty, there's only a restrained night watchman state. And welfare is assumed to be delivered spontaneously by a properly functioning market, even in a time of famine. And he had such deep faith in the system of natural liberty that I just want to give you these two examples, which I find quite amusing, which really bring home how much faith he has in the system of natural liberty and how much on the side of it he is. And this is his attitude to practices such as smuggling and the selling of dirty degrees. He said, what's the big deal? They're just rational reactions to the egregious legal restrictions on the system of natural liberty. The smuggler has in no way violated the more sacred laws of natural justice. They're probably an excellent person. But the laws of the country have made a crime which nature never meant it to be so. They're just trying to do a bit of trade, get a bit of whiskey, some gin, some champagne, big deal. And then he also says, same with degree selling. And really, I agree with him on smuggling, not so much with degree selling. I just can't go there. And at the time, there was a huge controversy because at St Andrews, they'd sold a degree to a quack doctor, a stage doctor. And he's going, oh, big deal, he's not doing any harm. He's only on the stage. But he said, look, this is just something the poorer universities rationalistically do to turn a penny in a market that's already improperly and therefore unnaturally oligopolised by Oxbridge. He said, now, we've all got to turn a penny. We've got to make a buck. So that's a more familiar Smith, the lover of natural liberty. But the story's a lot more complicated. And it turns out that markets and the system of natural liberty are far more fallible than we might have imagined. And then we start to see his consequentialist and positive liberty tendencies in examples where he says, all right, the market's usually doing it, but sometimes it's not. So I'm going to talk about those cases now. So we know about the three famous exceptions of state action, collective action problems that the state must manage. And it wouldn't be a good idea to put it into the hands of private individuals. Defence, justice and police and infrastructure. Although for the latter, he tries to apply the user pay principles wherever he can. He never explains why, and I don't know why other Smith scholars don't get upset about this. It's always one of my pet peeves. And I know Smith doesn't owe me anything. He's Adam Smith and I'm not. But I would like an explanation for why we get the collective action problems. You can sort of work it out for yourself, but he doesn't feel like he has to explain. It's because he's thinking, well, I'm not trying to say this system's perfect. I'm just muddling through. And then he just fills the gap with one of his own solutions. So here's a bit of a collective action problem. I'll think of something to solve it. And such is the fourth function, which is the establishment of a part publicly funded education system to arrest declining literacy levels caused by sending out children at an early age to work. So he's noticing now that people are sending their kids out to work into the small-scale factory systems or on the streets rather than go to school. And also we've got the corrupting effects of the division of labour. And he says, look, an uneducated population is not only an unproductive and morally underdeveloped one, it's also disorderly. So the state's got good reasons for doing something about it. But by the way, he does say, look, even if it didn't have these good effects, we should still do it because it's nice to be educated. Everyone should read and write. Good points, Adam Smith. Anyway, what I find interesting about that case is it sits very uncomfortably with the system of natural liberty because it's both strictly compulsory and substantially publicly funded. And there are other illiberal aspects. So basically the enforcement mechanism is you can't go to work and you can't set up business until you've shown you've passed the exam. So there's an enforcement mechanism there. There's other illiberal aspects. It embodies an admission that commercial progress is not always positive. Second, that markets and negative liberty sometimes fail to equilibrate. Three, there are collective action problems that require the attentions of a coordinating coercive state, so it's coercive. And it's a significant form of redistribution that is available only to the children of the poor. He says, well, the rich can afford, they've got plenty of money. They go to Eton and places like that, let them pay for their own children's education. So that's a very important example of where Smith says, no, well, I think we need to have a state solution here. And there's a whole bunch of other interventions that scholars have made lists of. There are some sources if you're interested. For example, we might have temporary monopolies on the case of inventions and new books as an encouragement to the labours of learned men. Thanks, Adam Smith. I'll take it. I think it's a good one. And all are justified by their reference to their good effects, their utility, their necessity, their tendency to facilitate commerce in general, and to enhance what we would probably now call positive liberty. But again, he doesn't tell us why we need them. So how much redistribution is there in Smith? So some claim that Smith is so concerned with the poor and moral egalitarianism that he advances a distributive theory of justice. Based on, I don't think you say this, Sam, on a right to subsistence. No, but that's Whitsum and Young. And it's unclear that he's saying that. He's usually on the side of workers, producers and consumers, and he does want to create a world where benefits are distributed. But this doesn't equate to equal redistribution. It's not substantive equality, but mainly formal equality or equality of opportunity that Smith favours. I mean, he does want substantive happiness, but not substantive equality, and I'll come to that in a minute. But he's not a distributive justice guy, and he has an excursus on that. He says, I'm not the distributive justice guy, I'm the commutative justice guy. Don't get me muddled up. We might want to give something to a beggar, but we're not obliged to give anything to the beggar. So you think, okay, that's your position, right? And why is that his position? Well, as we all know, Smith loves independence and he loves autonomy. He thinks that's the natural state of a human being. He valued it very highly and he wanted everyone to enjoy personal and economic mobility. And nobody should be begging for a living. That's terrible. It's humiliating and it's unnecessary. People are perfectly capable of securing their needs for themselves if only they were encouraged to do so, he thinks. But I sometimes feel like he might be a bit blind to the needs of those with unchosen dependencies. And I also feel he has a bias towards the working poor. The working poor. If the poor aren't working, he's not as interested in them and worried about them. And then what's also weird is, and then I thought to myself, oh, he just loves work. He loves workers. But then I see his attitude to the indolent rich and I think, oh, okay. This is more complicated than I thought, so I'll come back to that. He knew that widows, orphans and the sick existed. What they're owed is unclear. If you're complaining of mere poverty, he said, that's not going to make people want to give you anything. That's just going to annoy them. It's going to excite contempt rather than fellow feeling. And the despised beggar is scarce any object of any serious commiseration. And this is an effective dynamic that Smith regards as predictable and actually natural. This is how people are. Poverty is not something to parade around in order to extract charity and redistribution. It's something to hide. It's a sign of your failure. And it's not going to elicit the sympathy of spectators. The rich man's proud. He walks around proudly, displaying his wealth. The poor man is ashamed. There's something in humans that makes them despise extreme poverty and economic helplessness, says Smith. And there's something in Smith that makes him disapprove of it as well. Mainly his love of independence and his faith in markets and work as the great liberators. So neither the state nor private people nor industries are obliged to provide for the poor, the sick and widows and orphans. And actually private citizens actively hurt the economy when they exercise charity. And his objection here is that charity is a clog on productive effort. It not only disincentivises the poor to work, but waste precious resources on unproductive members of society. Every prodigal, by feeding the idle with the bread of the industrious, tends only to beggar himself and the country. Individual effort and enterprise within a properly functioning market, which legally protected negative rights, was the more natural and enduring solution to the problem of poverty, thinks Smith. Case closed on redistribution, and this is what I was saying, Sam, that I started to rethink. No. There are exceptions where the rich should pay proportionally more tax than the poor, and then the explicit proviso that that excess be redistributed. Public education, I've already talked about. A higher road tolls on carriages of luxury. I mean, the really indolent rich really got on his nerves. Look at them clogging up the bloody basic infrastructure with their stupid carriages when people are trying to get their stuff to market. So we should tax them for being on the roads in those luxurious carriages and redistribute that to the poor in whose way they're getting. And there should be a high tax on house rents. And he said, that's not a problem. It's not very unreasonable, but he doesn't tell us why. We don't know why it's not unreasonable. He just says, well, the rich have more money. Yes, we know, Adam Smith, they got more money, but why is it okay to redistribute it? So although there's some redistribution, Smith did not identify a discrete right to it, nor did he want to eradicate inequality, as has been claimed. I don't think he did want to eradicate inequality. He was very annoyed by the indolent rich. They irritated him. And these are some pictures I've put up of how I imagine Smith thought of the indolent rich. They look really irritating. They're standing around doing absolutely nothing but showing off. And he said, isn't it awful how the labour time of the poor is in civilised countries sacrificed to maintaining these people in their ease and their luxury? He said, they're parasites, they're a pest. And then he says, all right, I'll calm down now, because I know they have their uses. I can't get rid of the rich, and I probably don't want to get rid of the rich, because class inequality actually serves vital system functions. First, their consumption habits of the ultra-rich provide employment for multitudes of workers, so that's the trickle-down effect, which he doesn't rely on much for his economy. But second, their conspicuous consumption provides an incentive for the poor to work, to maybe imitate some of that consumption, so they're very important as incentivisers. And third, the indolent rich are a mainstay of social order. And here we see Smith at his sociological genius. He's saying, look, we've got these mass societies right. Now, I'm the guy that I don't like a lot of police running around telling people what to do. Well, here we've got this spontaneous system of classes already interspersed throughout the society. Almost everybody has someone above them. And these are the people that are keeping society in order, not the police. It's classes, and we need them. He says class distinctions are natural. He says they didn't exist in pre-commercial times. They're an artefact of commercial modernity. Wherever there's great property and freedom, there's great inequality. If you're going to have freedom and you're going to have private property, you're going to get inequality. And I think he thinks this is just one of these natural artefacts of progress. And he talks about these a lot, these unintended consequences. We have a problem with commercial progress, and then the progress produces its own spontaneous solution. And he's one of them. You've got a mass society which could be unruly, but he said, no, it's not going to be unruly. He says, I know this is bad, but there are times when the prosperity and preservation of the state demands a certain diminution of the powers and privileges and immunities of a particular order. He doesn't particularly like it, but he can see it's useful. So he doesn't want to eradicate inequality. His main goal was only to eradicate absolute poverty, not relative poverty, Dennis Rasmussen's point, not mine, and I think it's a very good one. Yet, as I've mentioned, some redistribution is allowable. And I wondered, and this is to you, Sam, too, that I wondered if the right to subsistence, not that you're positing that, but might be implied in the idea of a natural wage. It might be implied in that. If there's a natural wage which is above subsistence, then there might be a natural right to it. And finally, I want to just reflect on Smith's failure to recommend the abolition of the slave trade, which seems really weird to me, because it's the most egregious violation of the system of natural liberty you could possibly imagine. He says that. It violates every personal and natural right known to a person. And Smith enumerates all the rights that it violates. It's the vilest of all states. What could be worse? It's also economically inefficient. Why is it even there, Smith says. Yet he's oddly silent on the question of abolition, except to say it would cause a general insurrection on the part of owners. Yes, it would have at the time. And also, state capture was going to stop that from happening as well. Smith loves order and stability, and he is cautious. He's a very cautious, order-loving liberal. Could this be the reason, or could this be part of the reason? And then the next burning question is, look, why should the poor laws be abolished but not the laws permitting slavery, a much more egregious burden on liberty, independence, welfare and happiness? And then confused or perhaps just dismayed at the failure of market forces to discourage the slave trade, he closes the subject with a prediction that slavery would never be abolished. And it's pretty clear that he did think it should be abolished. This would be the first thing he'd get rid of if he had his way. But he just doesn't say so. So that's what I find odd. But if anyone's found anywhere where he said it should be abolished, I'd love to hear about it, because I could have missed something. So confused, yes, I was trying to confuse you. I was trying to confuse myself. It's a discombobulating picture. But I think we can put it together if we think of Smith not so much as a hardline economic liberty, but as a negative liberty type liberal who sometimes embraced positive liberty and sometimes put other values like stability, expediency and good effects ahead of negative liberty. And the good life and how to achieve it for the greatest number of people, I think it was his ultimate commitment. What will it take to get the job done? And this is what it will take. Working within the natural liberty system, but being prepared to pivot if you need to. Sometimes his defence of liberty seems so perverse you can't believe it. The selling of dirty degrees, or else refusing for some state management of the corn supply during a famine. And there are other times when he very readily lets natural liberty go to get something good, to get something that's good for everybody. But he doesn't give us a kind of a rule or any guideline. He hasn't got one. And he doesn't feel apologetic about that because he doesn't think he should have to have a rule for it. So there are many tensions in Smith's discourse on how to address disadvantage and inequality, some of which can be reconciled, some of which cannot. And I'll just give you some examples. Is the absence of a right to subsistence consistent with the idea of a natural wage? I think so. The idea of a natural wage to him is a social science point. And the right to subsistence is a normative point. Although I should say sometimes Smith takes a normative point from the social science. But that's reconcilable. Why is some redistribution okay when Smith denies that anyone has a right to it? There's no actual right to redistribution, but sometimes you do it. Just like there's no actual discrete right not to vote, yet we know lots of people don't vote. But there's no actual right not to vote. Why should the poor laws be legally abolished but not the laws permitting slavery? Well, he thought they both should be abolished, I'm pretty sure. He just didn't say so. So that what I can't reconcile is why he's not saying so. Why is the indolence of the rich tolerated but not that of the indigent? Because the indolence of the indigent is not productive. The indolence of the rich is, it's indirectly productive. And why is it acceptable to offer subsidised education to the poor but to prevent industries from assisting their sick and widowed? Because the first example enhances productivity and the second one doesn't. But I would think his commitment to welfare would maybe suggest a little bit of leeway in the second example, but no. So here's my overall thought at the end of all this. Smith's right in the middle of spring cleaning. We've come across him in the middle of his spring cleaning. He hadn't finished either. He was still doing his work on political science. And probably wouldn't have got much more clarity anyway if he'd finished it. He's in the middle of this massive task of sorting out the proper responsibilities and relationship between the state and the market in a very fast-changing environment, especially in Scotland where the changes were happening super fast. It suddenly started commercialising and modernising. And every day there's a new social and economic problem that's emerging out of all this change. And so no wonder his approach sometimes seems inconsistent. And no wonder it sometimes seems untidy. He never promised a tidy solution. In fact, he says, don't even try for a tidy solution. That's not what you're going to be able to do. And I'll stop. Thanks.
Muchas gracias, Lisa, por una provocativa, ¿no es cierto?, presentación donde tú nos muestras, yo me imagino que vamos a tener muchas preguntas y reacciones, tú nos muestras las tensiones que existen en el pensamiento de Adam Smith en términos de la libertad negativa, positiva, el contraste de ricos y pobres, la justicia conmutativa distributiva, la igualdad era un egalitarian o no, impuestos, cómo tomamos los impuestos. En definitiva, también esta tensión entre, ponerlo en términos muy simples, un utilitarianismo y un consecuencialismo. Y yo creo que tu presentación conversa muy bien con lo que planteó Samuel ayer, Samuel Fleischacker. Y te quería hacer la primera pregunta antes de abrir al público, porque Samuel argumentaba, uno de los puntos era el pragmatismo de Adam Smith. Y tú sitúas la respuesta, y mi pregunta es, ¿cómo situarías tú esta respuesta a las tensiones? Porque tú también mencionas el contexto de la época, que de alguna manera podría explicar esa inconsistencia. Pero podría haber algo, como tú citas a Jacob Viner, ¿no es cierto? ¿Te acuerdas el paper de Viner? De que tal vez también Smith era el más grande de los eclécticos, decía él. Y cuando usaba la palabra ecléctico, era el que sabía elegir, ¿no es cierto? ¿Cuál era la mejor solución? Si es que elegía, porque muchas veces no elegía. Entonces la pregunta que te quería hacer, porque tú, esas inconsistencias son todas distintas, y si habláramos solo del contexto y la estabilidad, estaríamos más bien frente a un pensador conservador. Entonces, ¿cómo ves tú ese dilema? ¿Cómo resolvemos esas tensiones que incluso en algunos casos, como las presentas tú, podrían ser confusiones? Es una pregunta amplia, pero te la dejo.
If I've understood correctly, I think Smith, in terms of context, at the time, one of the reasons he liked the small state is because the state was the site of corruption. It was an overblown, bloated state. And that was the context, full of corruption. But there's other passages in Smith where he's sort of saying, you know, the state can get bigger as the society increases, as long as there's a good reason for it to have all these new functions. So I think this might be one of these, you know, you make this distinction between the universal and the sort of particular observations in Smith, Sam, and I think this is one about a particular one, that he's saying, in my place and time, the state's got to stay out of it because the state is overblown and overbloated, full of patronage and corruption. We need to make it smaller. But as we go along, as the state gets more better run, we can expand the role of the state. So I think that might be part of the context that will explain some of the contradictions in Smith. But I'm not sure if I understood your question. Yeah, I think he understood, like, in this time and place, there's not much I want the state to be doing because it's doing such a rotten job. But eventually it's going to be doing more stuff. And he's sort of saying, I can't predict. But there's a great passage, I've got a slide there, where he sort of says, look at all the new stuff the state's going to be doing when it's going to be building more stuff. And it's going to be fine. And it's actually going to be quite an expensive state too. We'll have to get more taxes to run it. But we have to take it down to ground zero, make it small, and then we can build the state up again, perhaps to be a bigger one.
Gracias, Lisa. Vamos a abrir a Sam. ¿Tiene una pregunta? Aldo.
Thank you, Lisa. There's a lot for us to talk about, which I'm not going to bring up here. And I liked your overall suggestions, of course, that Smith is a pragmatic thinker and is working things out as he goes. Mm. Let me just ask you, make one suggestion to you and ask you what you think about it. You talk about everything that Smith says that the state should do as exceptions to natural liberty, as if the position he's going for, which I don't think is true, would be something like the libertarian anarchist position, which natural liberty would mean everyone does everything on their own. In the case of defense and justice, there's a very easy way to see it as not exceptions at all, because what Smith means by liberty is something you exercise when you're in a condition that's free of violence. If somebody's exercising violence on you, you have every right to use violence back. But better yet, he certainly doesn't like the idea of private groups enforcing what they take to be the law at any point. Mm-hmm. So to have the state do that actually increases the liberty of everyone. And of course, fighting off external enemies is also necessary for anyone in the state to exercise liberty. So these aren't, exceptions to liberty at all. They are enhancements of it. But now, although I can see you might want to see infrastructure, say, as an exception, I'm not sure whether it is or not, when it comes to the education of the poor, he himself explicitly says that he's not just concerned about productivity, explicitly, he's concerned about the ability of the poor to make moral and political judgments. That's clear in the passage. If they can't make moral and political judgments, how are they free? So he doesn't say this explicitly, but couldn't one just say, at least for the education part of the third bucket of activities that he gives to the state, it's not an exception to natural liberty, it's part of it. So, I don't know, what do you think?
Well, I could show you the slide that I didn't. There's a bunch more slides where I talk about this issue. And of course, he sort of says, if we don't have justice and police, people won't be able to secure in the fruits of their labours. Why would we work? And why? How can we get progress? Of course we need it. Of course we need defence. We can't. Prosperous nations are more likely to be invaded than a poor nation. Again, it's all about freedom. I agree. A short answer to your question would be this. I'm kind of agreeing with what you're saying, because the state is a natural institution in Smith. It evolves naturally as we progress. It's an artifact of progress and with the institution of private property. So it's not an artificial entity at all. It's a natural entity. So I've kind of given you the bolderized version here, but we're basically in agreement. You can't have freedom, and that's why he's kind of a positive liberty person, without this other stuff. And this other stuff can't be in the hands, in private hands. But the education example is really interesting, isn't it? Because it goes quite far in terms of the ability not to be over-enthusiastic religiously, the ability not to be a mob. These are outside what we'd expect, you know, the stereotypical Smith to say. He has very nice reasons for wanting people to be educated, and much richer reasons than we would imagine normally. But I think we're kind of in agreement.
Aldo?
Muchas gracias, Lisa, por la...
Oh, so hang on, wait. Hang on.
Perfect.
Sorry, Aldo.
No problem. Muchas gracias por la exploración que nos han mostrado y las tensiones en el pensamiento de Smith en torno a este punto. Reflexionaba respecto del concepto de felicidad, ¿no? Porque en el siglo XVII el concepto de felicidad es un concepto que intenta capturar todas las diferencias sociales dentro de ese concepto y hacerlo como un concepto global, como después lo fue la solidaridad, por ejemplo, en el siglo XIX. Pero lo interesante que me parece de tu forma de presentar a Smith en relación al concepto de felicidad es que aun cuando hay una referencia al average happiness, a la felicidad media, por decirlo así, también hay muchas preocupaciones referidas al lado externo de la felicidad, que es la infelicidad, ¿no? Entonces, por tanto, pareciera ser que Adam Smith no solo se preocupa de la felicidad promedio, sino también de las infelicidades particulares. Y eso es lo que hace más amplio su pensamiento y lo lleva a las tensiones que tú muestras, ¿no? Y me parece que si eso es cierto, esto es dos siglos antes de Ana Karenina, ¿no? Como todas las familias son felices, son igualmente felices, pero son infelices de modos distintos. Me parece que aquí hay algo de eso también algunos dos siglos antes, en esta reflexividad que hace Smith entre felicidad e infelicidad para capturar los dos lados de esa distinción con distintos mecanismos, con el mercado y la libertad y la autonomía por una parte, pero por otro lado también con la intervención.
So, could you, is that a comment or do you have a question? Yeah. Thank you. So I'll just make a comment back, Aldo. What I missed from my presentation of his very worldly material idea of having, excuse all this coughing, I've got an allergic reaction to something in the pollens. He says, this is kind of his second-rate happiness. He sort of says, look, real happiness is the life of a philosopher and life of virtue. That's real happiness. What he's saying is, that's my happiness. I don't really care about money. I gave all my money away, actually. That's what Smith did. The life of virtue is the life of happiness. So it's even more layered than I showed today. There's so many more layers that other scholars work on. But he says, look, this is what we're going to be doing. Let's be glad that the Creator made everyone want to be happy in this superficial way, because let's face it, we need to eat. And we can't get other stuff unless we're eating, unless we have money for books, unless we have money for a bit of enjoyment or music or just to enjoy the good life. But this is a layered concept in Smith. It's not as quite as simple as I make out. Thanks, Elder.
David?
Thank you for the wonderful paper. Just a couple of quick points. I think there's a way of dealing with the anomalies in Smith, and that is that the term natural in Aristotelian logic means usual. And you can prove in that system that it's not necessary. So there have to be anomalies. So that's a provable consequence in Aristotelian modal logic. So, and the texts are in Smith's library. So check that. Yeah.
It's a very interesting insight, yeah.
The other one is the slavery business.
Oh, yeah.
The recent scholarship, not ours, but, you know, people who know a lot more, have shown that Wilberforce, the active ingredient in Wilberforce's appeal is directly taken from TMS. And so that it's not only Smith, but the people that Smith were influenced, and the fact that it's Wilberforce means it's really important. But thank you.
You mean he's providing the ammo?
Yeah. Absolutely. He's the weapon maker for the anti-slavery people.
Correct. And this is what's interesting. He's defended all these rights, these freedom rights, so eloquently, and yet he doesn't bring it to its logical conclusion. That's what's interesting. But he does provide the ammo, for sure.
Right.
Yeah.
Ignacio, después.
Muchas gracias por la presentación.
Oh, hang on, sorry. Jet lag. It makes you so dim.
Okay, here we go. Siempre me pareció muy, muy interesante en Smith, y usted lo retrataba bien, esta preocupación particular por los pobres, y en particular esta idea de que los pobres tienen que tener un nivel de dignidad que les permita presentarse sin vergüenza en público, que esos bienes necesarios van más allá de una renta de subsistencia, y que incluso ese nivel de dignidad es cambiante, como dice él a propósito de la camisa de lino o de los zapatos en Inglaterra, ¿no? Y entonces la pregunta es, ¿cuál sería la recomendación de política pública para lograr aquello, ¿no? En lugar de simplemente el salario de subsistencia. Una obvia, pensaría yo, es ampliar la sociedad comercial para que la riqueza y la prosperidad, ¿no es cierto?, beneficie a todos y particularmente a los más pobres y tengan este nivel. Pero mi pregunta en consecuencia es, ¿qué pasa en la transición? Cuando uno hace un claim fuerte a favor de este nivel de dignidad, bueno, uno esperaría en el gradualismo de Smith, hagamos las cosas graduales y ya llegará el momento en que sobrepasemos este nivel de subsistencia, o este nivel de dignidad más bien. Pero ¿qué pasa entre medio? Y a propósito de su discusión de los impuestos, ¿cómo vería Smith algún esquema de transferencias transitorias para apoyar precisamente ese gradualismo y esa transición, o si usted quiere ponerlo en términos contemporáneos, una renta mínima que complemente el ingreso de mercado de las personas hasta alcanzar ese nivel de dignidad? Gracias.
Thank you. Great question. You can do two policy measures, some decent wages that people have enough to live on, and hopefully enough to buy a little something to brighten the day. This will also stimulate production. Secondly, take off the sumptuary taxes and stop moralizing about these things you're calling luxuries. He's saying luxury is a relative term. What's a luxury in France is not a luxury here. This proves there's no such thing as a luxury, really. It's all relative. So stop moralizing it. So you can ask the church or to stop moralizing about it, and stop making out that only the poor that don't enjoy anything will go to heaven. Everyone's going to heaven, and everybody can have a little bit of luxury. But the state shouldn't be moralizing either, because the state had been moralizing with its sumptuary taxes. So take a tax off luxuries. So there's a couple of things you can do in the short term. And also, he was trying to change the normative attitude to luxury, and I think he was succeeding a little bit too.
Thank you, Lisa. We have the last question here.
Thanks, Lisa. It's going to even be an Australian accent.
Yes, it's an Australian accent. So, yes, welcome to Chile from an Australian Chilean. The title of your presentation today, thank you for the presentation, Happiness, Welfare, Equality and the State, led me through your conversation. I was thinking of the evolution of the welfare state, which England is the exemplar. Yeah, exactly. And I was also thinking of another state called the United States. And life, liberty and the pursuit of happiness is the creed of the Declaration of Independence, the pursuit of happiness, not the attainment of happiness. And so I wondered your thoughts on those two different views of happiness through welfare or happiness through the pursuit of happiness that are exemplified in the state models of the United Kingdom and the United States of America, that coincidentally its War of Independence is occurring in around the death of, around the end of Adam Smith's life. So, your thoughts on those two different models of state in relation to Adam Smith's idea and the concept of welfare, particularly, and happiness.
Yeah, I think it goes to the point I was making about him wanting to not eradicate absolute poverty. It has to be like a race. He's a true liberal in that way. It's kind of teleological, but it's open-ended. We don't know where we're going, and we shouldn't know who's going to win the race, but everyone should get a chance. All state impositions or restrictions should be taken off. Let everyone start at the starting gate, and let's just see what happens. It has to be open-ended for a true liberal, I think. It's not going to be substantive equality. So I just think one setting is more liberal than another, or more negative liberal than another, or maybe more classical liberal than another. Does that answer your question? I think it's this idea that it should be open-ended, but we should just let competition rip and let people work it out for themselves.
Bueno, tenemos que agradecerle calurosamente a Lisa esta conversación y su presentación. Y los dejamos cordialmente invitados para mañana, que presentará Patrick Brian Hanley, que está acá, Mauricio Cutiño, y el que habla para finalizar esta fiesta intelectual que han sido estos tres días dedicados a los 300 años de Adam Smith. Así que muchas gracias.